Hey guys, hello and welcome. This is Jim Fuge and this is guitarbyjimi.com. And I am pleased to say in this lesson I'm going to do Hot Dog by Led Zeppelin. I'm going to do the entire solo, note for note, as is guitarbyjimi.com, 100% off the record. All right, so you're going to learn this the right way. And it is my pleasure to do this for you guys for free, to just show you what you get when you go on my website and you buy videos, since this is the kind of stuff you're going to get. So let's get into the lesson. What a great solo by Jimmy Page. I gotta say, yet another great solo. I kind of get tired of saying that, actually, don't I? I'm gonna preface this by saying, well, you know, I did the video already with the opening riff, so that's done already. It's a separate video if you're looking for that. But this is just a solo. So let's talk about it, shall we? Let me just make sure I'm in a good spot here. The first thing I'm gonna say about this solo, it is. You ready for this? It is so not what you think it is. I guarantee you. When you watch and you see the exact notes I'm playing in the phrasing, the solo is so not what you think it is. Okay? And as a matter of fact, I'll go into what a lot of people think it is and why it's wrong. And I'll show you the complexity of Jimmy Page while I'm doing it. So let's get on to it, man. Hot Dog. Here we go. So, you know, this is a little mini lesson too. So listen, you know, it's kind of important to, you know, remember what key you're in and what chords are going on behind you while you're playing, because this is important. And then this makes you understand, like, why Jimmy Page did some of the things that he did, right? So, and it's pretty much G, C, and D, 1-4-5, you know? Right, so, you know, so that kind of thing. So, it's important to know those chords, what are going on behind you, because what he's doing, you know, it makes you understand better what he's doing, and I'll explain it when we get to that part. So, let's get into it. So, I kind of have my guitar, which is a Heritage, by the way. This is an old Heritage guitar. It's a great guitar. I have it on the, it's probably a Telecaster would he use, but I think. But I have it on my bridge pickup, and I can single coil it. So, I kind of have a twangy. See that? So, okay, so let's get into the lead. I can't wait to teach this to you guys, and you're going to be shocked. But I guarantee you, 100%, after you learn it the way I'm teaching it to you, if you learn it exactly the way I'm teaching it to you, and you go back to the record and you play with it, it'll be flawless, 100% off the record, because this is Guitar by Jimmy. Where's my website name? It's either here or here. Hello. So anyway, okay, so anyway, so he starts off like this, and it's in this position, by the way. I've seen people do it like this. So here's the wrong way to do it, okay? And I'm going to do it here for a minute. Here's the wrong way to do it. It's great. It sounds like, you know, it's a nice simple pattern, but that's just not what he's doing. And one of the notes is so wrong that this is really important for me to point it out to you, and I'll tell you why he did what he did. Okay, so the correct way, believe it or not, like I said earlier in the beginning, this lesson is so not what you think it is, these notes. But I guarantee you, with 100% certainty, if you go back and listen to it, this will be, in fact, off the record. Okay, so it starts off like this, and most of it is picked, okay? So I won't get into the picking because it'll take me forever, but unless it's really important what I'm going to say, I'll talk about the picking. But otherwise, it's down, up, alternate picking, all right? And then he does hammer a few things, so it's the first two notes. Then he goes like this, believe it or not. Okay, it's not, it's, okay, then he goes right to D, dun, 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 twice, in like this positioning how I'm doing it, then C sharp, not C. It's not at all C. Now C, now here's the mini lesson, and I'm going to, don't worry, I'm going to do everything over and over. C is, you know, in the G major scale, great. So that's where sometimes guitar players don't use their ears, they just use logic only, and they say, well, that's good though, that's a good thing, it's not a bad thing. You're in the key of G, you're in a major key and all that, and the stuff that's going on behind you is simple G, C, and D. So therefore, logically, it probably should be, you know, forget this part. But anyway, so just, it should be this. Right? That's logically what people do. That's good, actually, that you think like that, and you're thinking about the chords, and you're thinking about the scales a little bit. But you can't always assume because it makes perfect sense that that's what Jimmy Page did or anybody. So you have to listen. You have to really listen closely. Now, what he did purposely, no doubt about it, is do C sharp instead of C. Because it sounds like, na 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 na, I told you so. Right? He's doing it on purpose. Now, I mean, I won't get heavily into this, but this is, what is it? It's the linear mode, I believe, right? It's got a flatted fifth. So, I mean, you don't have to get crazy into modes and all that right now, but that's he's purposely doing that. He could have went, listen to it, you hear the difference already? See how wrong the C note is when you slow it down in your head and you think? So now the C sharp note, forget about music theory for a minute, the C sharp note is more of that lead-in, he's trying to do rockabilly thing, country thing. That would be more like what a country player would do. And this lead break, by the way, is very Chet Atkins-ish, which means, we'll get to it, you know, when he's playing chords. He's not going. He's holding the rhythm with his bass notes. So, okay, so that's another thing, too. It's important about the sleeper. You have to play it right. So let's get back to it. So anyway. It's great. Same thing here. Well, not really the same thing. That's why this thing is tricky. And don't think like the first time around. This is what he's doing. Kind of simple. Not like the first time. Okay, then he goes just like this. Not a double G shot like the first phrase. So those two phrases are not exactly the same, you know. He doesn't hit the G twice, you know, later he does, but he doesn't do it here. So, and he doesn't do, so it's just, that is what it is. They're close, but they're not the same. One more time. Twice. Love that C sharp note. Just once on the G. Okay, let's move on. Okay. Then the same thing. This is a good example of phrasing, how the same exact notes can sound different because they're phrased. They're played differently in time and accentuation. So, the second time is like together more. Okay. Then he stretches up to a B note. And when he comes down, he grabs a D note. Okay. Okay. Every time you get, every time you come down off this thing, you're hitting the D note. It's not every time. He's not doing that. He's going. Excuse me. Okay. You can hit it at the end. That's fine. All right. So now, so far we got. Okay, now comes the fun part, and it gets tricky. There's one really hard part at the end. So now, this is why I said what's going on behind us, right? Now we're on a G chord. So what he's doing, absolutely, 100%, purposely, and this is what he does. He's playing a chord. He's kind of mimicking a G6-9 chord, which is this chord. So, you know, if you don't know music theory, it's not a bad idea to learn a little bit, because obviously Mr. Page knows this. That's why he did it. He's kind of doing these, you know, this kind of a chord. That kind of a chord that the Beatles sometimes would end songs on live. It's G with the sixth and the ninth. Nice, right? So, but he's doing it in a really wacky inversion. You ready? So he slides up, and he's holding a B, D, B, E, and A note, okay, and a D note down here. Crazy, isn't it? So he's going like this. Then he hits a quick A note. Just only hits the A note once. It's not It's not kind of that thing. It's just... Okay. Excuse me. Sounds a little crazy, but that's what he's doing. He's trying to get... I listened to all the notes, believe me. It's starting on a low B note, and there's the sixth is in here. This is a G6-9, and the ninth is in here, and then he gets it up here, too. And I know, now this is where I am going to use Logic. He does this again later, but in another different inversion. Wait till you see this. This lead break is so much trickier than you think. So, and crazier than you would have ever imagined. But trust me on this, when you play this back the right way, you'll be amazed that Jimmy Page is doing all this stuff. Okay? Then he's going to go to like this. Let's see, with a ninth over here. So, the last note is G, not B flat. It's two times back and forth, then the C, G. Okay, so the notes, just simplistically speaking, are... But now don't forget, you have to do this Chet Atkins thing and go, keep the... Oops. Oops. See how I'm trying to get that low bass in there? It's hard to slow this down, by the way. That's why I made a mistake. It's so much easier for me to play it fast, but watch. Okay, then this... phrasing is quicker. Okay? So kind of the same thing. Then he slides up to here. Now you're on a D chord at this point. So he's kind of doing like a, making it sound like a... Kind of almost like a ninth. Hits it twice. Then he goes. Okay? Then he goes, slides to an A note. Now don't forget, you're back on the G chord again. So he does this G6-9, but in a different inversion. Now look, check this out. And I'll tell you why this is definitely, he's not doing it the same way that he did it the first time. Check this out. I actually might have to go down here because it's too small to show you here. So let me do that. So he puts his finger, this is insane, right? He puts his finger on an E note on the A string, a high A note on the E string, and a G note here on the B string, and then an open G. Because, and now see the reason why I know this is right and not the same as this? It sounds close. Oops, sorry. Because I can, excuse me about that. I'm looking at the camera and looking at this. I'm losing my marbles. You should probably use your middle finger. I mean, I fall into my ring finger up here, but it's too tight. So maybe it might be easy if you use your middle finger. So your middle finger on an E note, your index finger on a high A, your ring finger on a high G, and that's it. And then open G. Now the reason why I know this is right is because there's an open G this time around. All right. And then he also sounds like he slides really far and really heavy, like on the A string, which leads me to believe that he's doing it in this way. Also, last but not least, he's toggling back like this. And the G and the A keep ringing out, as opposed to like this. It's like, you can hear him toggling out, and you can hear this open G string being crashed really hard. So he goes, watch. You can hear him slide really far, too. So it's kind of like the boom. It's kind of like this. That kind of vibe. So let me do it down here. So let me do it fast a minute. So he's toggling back between, it's kind of like this is the bass note and this is the rhythm down here. So, I Okay. Okay. Then he goes again. Okay. Same thing. But now, if you notice on this part here, he plays this, he backs off a lot in this pick. He goes. Okay, now here comes, and listen to, and now too. Okay, I'm going to put this phrase and break it like this. So, B flat, B, G, then D, G. And he plays it lighter. Okay? Okay? I'm going to break it like that because if I do the whole thing, you're never going to get it. It's fast, too. And I'll tell you why I really believe exactly this is how he's playing it, fingering-wise, too. Because you can hear stuff ringing out. So if you got that part, the next thing is a C-sharp and G, then C. You can hear it ring out. So that's why I'm suspected thinking he's doing it like this right now. And then I'm also suspected thinking that the next part is in fact slid up, and then it makes sense where his fingers are going to go. So, okay, just take it like that, because when you put this all together, watch how fast this goes. This is the hardest part right now, is the hardest part of the lead break, hands down. Okay. Okay, you see how fast it's getting? All right, now, it's so hard to slow this down. Then he goes. Okay. B flat, B, D. Open E. Okay. G. Like this. F sharp. G. E. And let it ring out as much as you can. Because if you listen to the sleep break, you can hear stuff ringing out. You can hear it moving. And then you can hear like. So what he's trying to do now is mimic like a rockabilly player going. Like the open kind of string. Okay, I'd love to say that all he's doing is this, but he's not. I listen to all the notes. So this is definitely what he's doing, and it's really fast, which may explain why he gets tripped up a little bit. Sorry, Jimmy Page, you know I love you. He gets a little tripped up in the next. He gets a little bit faster than what Bonham was playing on the beat. So, because he comes into it fast. So, let's do this part again. Okay. Sounds like it's crazy right now, but it's right. I'm going to speed it up just a little bit, but not fast yet, just so you can hear it. Let me get back before it. See how fast that comes? That's not even up to speed either. So, you hear it now? You see, you can hear these. Hear that open E. So let's do it again. So crazy, right? So wait till I play this whole thing up to speed, you'll see it. Then he goes to the last part. Okay, this is like a little exercise. Okay. okay? No extra F sharp at the end, no extra F sharp. Okay, then back to this. But now he does hit the G note twice. Okay, so, I mean, it is what it is. Whether it's a mistake or not, I don't know. He could have, you know, whatever, it was splitting hairs, but he definitely hits it twice there and not in the beginning. Last one. Get into the blues area for the only, probably only the part of the lead break that he got a little bluesy on. Very subtle. He's not going. Watch that B flat. See how he's a little, slightly it's tucked in? Then, so the last note is G. Then he goes, probably here. I know people play it here. It sounds great, sounds twangy here, but don't forget he's on a Telecaster or something like that. He's on a single coil pickup. So right here, it's up to you, whatever you want to do it, but think about it like this. I'd really be surprised if Jimmy Page went, jumped all the way here. I mean, I don't know, it just seems a little weird to me. I really doubt he would jump all the way here just for that last part. So anyway, and this one, I think he probably did it this way. I kind of like pluck it with my fingers and my pick. And the last one's just one shot. Let your fingers, your fretted hand do the rest. Okay, so that's the ending part. All right, I mean, if you want to do it here. Now, you know, this does not as easy as it sounds. Try not to bend the D note. See, so you got to have a little more finesse and control. Part of it's technique, part of it's using your ears as you're playing, okay? Let's try it from the top. This is an exciting lead break, and I hate to tell you, but if you try it up to speed, it's not easy. This is definitely, no doubt about it, the hardest part. See, it's right into that next part, so that's how you, and you know, you listen to this phrase. And that's probably why you got tripped up here. You might too, when you're coming from this thing. See, you know what I'm saying? So, all right, so let's do it. I'm going to do it nice and slow and rhythmically. Here we go. Okay, so let's take the whole thing slow again, all right? So let's take it from the top, all right? So I would do it nice and rhythmically. A hot dog. So all the way back. It's really just finger picking. I'm not sure if he finger picked this part, but it's kind of hard based on what he's trying to do fast. Okay. Now he does that G twice, right? Not blues. So you're very quiet on the B flat. looking at. What's the other alternative? Just pick it down. I really think he picked it with his, plucked it with his middle finger. That's such a rockabilly country thing to do. Hear the difference? That's a nice little technique too. So, one more time slow. Isn't that C sharp note great? Now get to the D in. It's only when you hear that you get the D note in. Great, isn't it? But you gotta put it in between chords. Oops. It's rockabilly, that's what he's doing. He's doing rockabilly, Chet Atkins kind of thing. Go all the way up here. Hear him slide all the way? Keep your fingers there. I'm just trying to accentuate what the notes are. It's fast too, man. It's not an easy lead break, and it's tricky stuff that he's doing. You hear the open G, and he's going like this. You hear they both ringing out? That's how I know that these must be the position that he's playing it in. I'm piecing it all together like a detective. I know what the notes are, but now the second part of the story is, well, how did he really play it? Because it can matter. You know, I can figure this out in a different way, but it won't sound right. And he definitely has an open G, and he definitely did a big slide up to here. And then, you know, he's toggling these two back, and they're ringing out with an open G. So I know he must have been at least kind of like this. Then I'm piecing this as the last piece of the puzzle. And it's a 6-9 chord, effectively, right? Yes, 6-9 chord. Okay, so he's kind of doing the same chord, but in a different way, different version. Quiet down. Okay, the reason why this gets tricky is you feel like you hear D, G, C sharp, G, C, G, open strings. You feel like you hear the same notes 100 times over. That's why it's tricky, because you feel like you say, man, what is he doing? You feel like he's just going. But he's not. He's got a very specific pattern to what he's doing. Okay. Let it ring out. Ring out. No extra G note. Now. Now. Crazy, right? All right. All right. Crazy, I know, but it's what he's doing. Sorry. Okay. So let's see if we can do it up to speed. Ahaka! Down. Oops. So that's what I get for trying to talk while I'm teaching, trying to play it up to speed. So, I little slide there. Sorry, I forgot to mention it. Now you'll find playing Jimmy Page or Clapton for that matter, or Beck, he has really has a lot of finesse. Really a lot of finesse. So you gotta really take your time, learn it right, and get the finesse. The finesse is so important. Don't just learn the notes. You gotta get that kind of Jimmy Page twang and swagger, as one of my students said. Swagger, I like that word, thank you. And you know what I mean, you wanna get all this stuff right, so. And it doesn't make sense to do it here. And besides, you can hear the higher strings. It sounds makes more sense. And this is where the opening riff is. So, see how I'm keeping the rhythm? Up fast, right? That's fast. That's the hardest part, no doubt about it. See, look how much is going on. See? Oops. It's a nice little exercise. Don't forget the double shot. Little slide, little whip, that's a clapping thing too. Just watch the B flat note. See how it's just very tucked in there? That's a Page finesse thing. Oops. So grab the B with your underneath your middle finger. I just gotta play one more time. I can't resist. I love this lead break. What a great lead break. So, by the way, another point, another important, very important point of this lesson is don't ever underestimate Jimmy Page. You know, if things sound nice like this, that's great. I mean, it makes complete, perfect, logical sense as a pattern, but don't ever assume with the Beatles or Led Zeppelin. Those are two bands that are so tricky, way beyond people to even realize, and this is a perfect example. Right? You see the C-sharp note? That was 100% on purpose. You know, and you hear the difference in it? So, like, you know, don't... And then it's not a complete pattern, as you just seen. You know what I mean? And this part... He doesn't jump. He goes... So, you know, I think he goes... I don't... It's definitely not a mistake. I think he just went for more what sounds right to him melodically when he did his lead break, because Page really planned out a lot of his lead breaks. I mean, he was a great live player. He can play 25 minutes straight like Dazed and Confused and just jam. And by the way, Dazed and Confused is live, is a very structured live jam. If you listen to Led Zeppelin really early, maybe even as far back as 68, they were playing most of that collage of sections. Very, at least the sections were very structured. You know, he didn't just say, hey, let's just go. He didn't just say, let's just do that. You know, and a lot of it's, you know, carried on in later gigs when they did Madison Square Garden in 73 or whatever it was. Song remains the same and all that, you know. So, you know, even though it sounds like they're just jamming, you know, Jimmy Page had a lot of structure. He was a great session player and studio musician and producer, as we know. So, and I'm pretty sure when he did his lead breaks, most if not all of them, he, after the band did all this stuff, he would go in and do his lead breaks and take a lot of great care and time And I think the only person who was with him was really the engineer, I think, Eddie Kramer, because at least he needed somebody to help him, you know, put the mic on and this and that and roll the tape so he can play at least play guitar, right, as the actual musician and not the producer. So I know this is another example of Jimmy Page. I'm sure he really thought this Lee breakthrough. I'm positive he didn't just jump on and say, let's just hope for the best. You know what I mean? There's too much complexity in this lead break. You know, just to think these chords through. It's great. So I'll do one more time slow. Slide the whip. The last one is not picked twice. Okay, so that, my friends, is Hot Dog. What a great Libre. Is that a great Libre or what? So now you learn a lot about chords, learn a little bit about theory, because, you know, Jimmy Page was very conscious of what he was trying to do. Obviously he knew the chords going on behind him, and he wanted to really get that rockabilly country meets a little bit of rock and roll and fuse it all together. And that's why he chose these classy chords like this G6-9. Real classy, man. I can't make this stuff up. Look at this. Look at this. Isn't that amazing? That's great. Jimmy Page is such a genius. And so, that is Hot Dog, guys. I hope you enjoy it. Feel free to comment. I'd love to hear your comments. And check out my website, guitarbyjimi.com. It's either here or here. Where are you, little red sign? So www.guitarbyjimi.com, where you finally learn the solos really off the record, and hopefully a lot more in each lesson. You know, I never just teach the actual lesson. I always, as you can see, I go off a little bit on purpose, because I'm just trying to make you a better guitar player. It's not just learn the solo and that's it. Then, you know what I mean? I mean, I like to try and teach people the guitar. And I just happen to be teaching you Hot Dog, but I'm teaching you the guitar, so I kind of take a lot of great care. You learn a lot more when you learn the little things too, not just the actual notes of the lead break, which is great, don't get me wrong, but when you learn, you know, hey, he decided to do a 6-9 chord here, and here's why. You know what I'm saying? There's things like that. They make you a smarter player. They make you get more depth. And plus, I really take a lot of care to get stuff off the record. I mean, I really, really am 100% positive that what I teach is 100% off the record, note for note. And, you know, if you want to be sure, go listen back to the lead break. If once you get this down, play with it, and you'll be amazed that this is flawless off the record. Because, you know, I'm showing my age, I put the record player on 500 to 1,000 times on average by the time I get this stuff. If anything's stumping me, I'll go back and just keep playing it over and over and over and listening to it, playing with it, not playing with it, listening to it, just to see, you know, hum the notes that I'm hearing, think about trying to piece the puzzle together. Is there an open note in here? That's how you really figure stuff off the record. When you're trying, you got to be a little bit of a detective, but obviously you have to really use your ears. You have to really, really listen. And you never can assume. That was one of the other important points of this lesson, especially with Led Zeppelin and Beatles. I'm telling you, the Beatles too, no doubt about it. Those two bands are the trickiest bands that ever walked the face of the earth. They are so tricky, you have no idea. If you think the Beatles are a simple band, you're crazy. You got to really listen to all the stuff that those guys did, and I'm sure Led Zeppelin is well aware of that, by the way. I think they had a lot of admiration for each other. But I'm going off on a tangent and say I love Led Zeppelin so much. I get a lot of kick out of this too. It's not just teaching, but I love to, to share this kind of knowledge. So when you figure stuff out, use your ears, but don't assume. Otherwise, you would have passed this very, very important C-sharp note that makes so much of a difference in the melody of what he's playing and the twang, right? It's got the na-na-na-na-na. Isn't that great? And plus, since it's a C-sharp note, it's actually leading into the next chord. It's kind of causing that G riff. It's kind of causing it to be leading into the C by virtue of this C-sharp note. Jimmy Page was smart, man. Believe me, he thought all this stuff through. There's no doubt about it. So, again, don't assume when you're figuring out Led Zeppelin. It's never as easy as it seems. And, again, the hardest part is this. Just one right after the other. But it's hard. It's fast, as you can see, when I did it up to speed. So, I hope you like that. I have a lot of Led Zeppelin on my website. I have Black Dog. I have Heartbreaker. Yes, Heartbreaker. Note for note. 100%. You'll never find it more accurate than on my website. I'm telling you, man. Part one and part two. I had to break it into two parts because each lesson was like an hour. It's ridiculous. I spent so much time on that one lead break. It took me ridiculous amount of weeks just to get that video nice. So I would teach it perfectly. And, by the way, when I play Heartbreaker, I'm forced into a stupid bar. So I have to use my bar and pull it up because I have a lock here. I can't use my thumb the right way that he did it. So whatever. I just thought I'd mention that. So that's Hot Dog, and like I said, I have a lot of great. I have Black Dog on there. I have a lot of great Led Zeppelin leads, and I'm working on No Quarter right now. And I'm telling you, man, you should see No Quarter. It's going to blow your mind. It's going to be on the website. I'm going to have to charge for it because, again, it's almost an hour long. It's too involved of a lesson. There's so much musical information in it besides the lead break. It's just the way I teach, but. So check it out when you get a chance. Go to my website and check it out. So I'm Jim Fuge, and this is guitarbyjimi.com. This is Hot Dog, and I hope you enjoyed this as much as I enjoyed teaching it to you guys. Send me comments and let me know if you have any questions or anything. Happy to help you. All right, guys, take care and rock on, and good luck. Take your time with it and do it slow first, okay? So you make sure you get it accurate, then build up your speed. All right, talk to you soon.